You need to show up. You need to be willing to take action, to stand up in the world, in the dream that you made, and make a declaration that this is not true, that it was a mistake. I'm sorry.
Say sorry.
Forgive me. This was a mistake. I was wrong. I was wrong entirely about everything. And I've discovered in my recognition that I was entirely wrong, that God created me eternal and perfect and wholly loving and innocent, unchangeable, free of suffering, free of guilt, free of death, disease, pain, anxiety. That was all my own mistake, but I remain now as I have always been. So that's certainly a declaration that you must learn to make within the dreaming of a world and all the situations and circumstances in which you might find yourself, right? Because it's in those situations and circumstances that you begin to find the temerity, the cojones, the strength of spirit, right, that you must discover, the power given to you to be a teacher of God and a denier of the world and an asserter of the singularity of truth that does deny this world in time. So that's a great vocation, and you can't do it by thinking about it. You can't do it by practicing it. You can only do it by doing it, can't you?
Indeed.
You learn by putting yourself into a very real scenario where previously you were too afraid to go. You step out and it's a risk in that sense. You step out in what previously was seemed to be a dangerous situation. And certainly without trust, it would be fearful. Trust that you're not alone. So that's all part of it. And there's a great appreciation for your determination to accept that you are the means that God has established for the salvation of the world, not someone else. That all bets are on you. There's no plan B. You're it. And so the certainty is that, you know, somewhere in time you did complete your assignment. Who knows? Who knows when that will be, but certainly we know that it is determined by you in your own mind. And the only obstacle, of course, is the obstacle of yourself. Your own, the inertia of your self-concept, or the inertia of gravity, you know, the weight of death urge that has taken hold within the mind and has become a very powerful program, a previous mind training from which it is impossible to overcome without the very real help that is available. So that leads us directly to somewhere like lesson 167. There is one life, and that I share with God. In this world there appears to be a state that is life's opposite. You call it death. Yet we have learned that the idea of death takes many forms. Death is not a future. What we're expressing is death is not a future event. This is death. This is, as Jesus said, I arose from the tomb. The world is the tomb. You are in the tomb. This is the grave. This is the hole you dug for yourself in which you're going to die, in a sense. Everyone who comes here came for the purpose of demonstrating that you can crucify and kill the Son of God, right? And you're hell-bent on demonstrating that. That has been preordained within your mind, right? That drama or enactment has been set in motion. Until you change your mind, and until you accept your own eternal life, that is the drama that you will enact, right? And that you will teach by enacting it. So it is the one idea. It's an idea, first of all. Right? Death is an idea. Well, that's good news to start with, because if it's an idea, then it's an idea within my mind. Right? It's an idea in mind. And what you're discovering is that mind is all there is. And that you have power within the mind to make decisions, to make a choice, to make a better choice, perhaps, or to undo the choice that you had previously made. So it's an idea that underlies all feelings that are not supremely happy. These are some of the sentences that you take and you love, because you begin to understand that when you're not supremely happy, you're dead. Right? You've accepted an idea of death. That's what death is. Any experience that's not entirely joyful. So death is not a future event. Huh? It's an idea in the mind, okay, which of course does have a drama that's played out within, upon the stage. You strut and fret. Your arrow upon the stage, and then you are heard no more. Right? Even Willie could see that it was a tale told by an idiot full of sand and fury, signifying absolutely nothing. These are the fun things he slipped into your cultural experience. And you go, oh yeah, that's very nice. And that's quite right. But you still couldn't find a way out of the death that you had already, the play that you already written for yourself, shall we say. The script had been written. And what you're discovering here in our association with Jesus is what it takes to rewrite the script, or to accept a new script that has been written for you, as you're willing to set aside the script that you had set for yourself, written for yourself previously. So these are great lessons. It's the one idea that is not supremely happy, and it is the alarm to which you give response of any kind that is not perfect joy. Any response that's not perfectly joyful to your brother is wholly part of that idea of death. All sorrow, loss, anxiety, and suffering, and pain, even a little sigh of weariness, a slight discomfort, or the merest frown, acknowledge death. He's not going to leave you any wriggle room at all, is it? There's no room for any movement. So, yeah, boy, no justification for death whatsoever. Huh? And thus denies you live. Whether you're aware of it or not, you came into a scenario that's been set up to teach A Course in Miracles, the lesson that Jesus came to offer, which there is no death, right? And his little life was not enough to teach this to the world, so that there would be a fundamental awakening. But when you come into this association, you become subject to the teaching, isn't it? Because all that Jesus is going to say, what you think of it as love in this world, is in fact what death is. Yes or no?
Yes.
I mean, you can't get around that. If you're with Jesus, right? Did we teach that yesterday or the day before? Absolutely. Huh? It's the entire opposite. Everything in this world is a form of fear, including love. Right? It's the reality of love has got nothing to do with this world. It has got nothing to do with the illusion of love, which is all this world can offer you. The illusion of love is, of course, your need to perpetuate the delusion that you have an identity that can seek and find happiness or a moment of joy within hell, within the denial of your own reality, that you can justify this place and make it real. But the only thing that you can seek for and make real here is death. That's all the lesson is, isn't it? So that's why the lesson is that you must look. Nobody wants to. Nobody wants to look at the idea of death. But Jesus is saying, I want you to look at the idea of death. Unless you look at it, you can't escape from it, for goodness sake. Because you do not believe that you made death. You believe that there's a god of death outside of yourself and he's doing it to you. Holy mackerel. When are you going to wake up? When are you going to hear this? Because when you hear it, you will wake up. There is no cause of death outside of you. It's an idea within your mind that has absolutely nothing to do with God. Nothing whatsoever. God is eternal. That's the lesson. There is one life that I share with God. Oh, that's very nice. And you go off and you're miserable and happy and you continue to dream a drama. You get old, you get sick and you die again and again and again. Until when? Until you hear the lesson. Maybe it's now. Maybe you'll hear it now. Maybe you'll go through many iterations of the birth-death cycle until finally you're desperate enough to get down on your knees and go, I need help. I need help. I'm willing to listen to the help that's been given to me. Right? Who knows? As I said, who knows when you as an individual will hear this? But certainly you will only hear it when you have to hear it.
Yes.
When you have no choice but to hear this. Do you understand?
Yes.
You're not going to hear this until you have no choice. Maybe you'll be on your deathbed. Maybe you'll be in great pain. Give me some more opium to take this pain away from me so I can die in peace at least. Maybe at that point you'll go, oh, I remember that experience I had. I remember that lesson. Maybe. Who knows when? But all that Jesus is saying is, look, it's not what you think. You are circumscribed by false beliefs about yourself, and that constitutes the entirety of your experience as a human being. Right? You need to open your mind a chink, just a little, so that an alternative becomes a possibility. Okay, that's all, isn't it? You pick up the book, you go, A Course in Miracles? Wow, I think I want to try that. And then you go to the workbook and you go, well, this is a very strange course. The first lesson says, what does it say? Yeah, see, you've been trained to accept a very strange lesson. Nothing I see means anything. It's the beginning of taking a crowbar and levering open your mind. You know, it takes great willingness and force to open your mind sufficiently. You know, it says you don't have to believe it. You might hate it. You might want to throw the book out of the window. Many people have. You might want to burn it. You might object to it. You might physically feel repulsed. You might feel nauseous at the idea. And some of the ideas, you probably do feel nauseous. Right? Don't worry about that. Just read the effing lesson. Contemplate for a moment the possibility of that idea. You understand? Huh? Such is the defensive nature of your own mind. Right? You've built a wall. You've built a castle. You've built a strong citadel to keep love away, to keep God out and maintain your idea about yourself. And all the world that you made justifies that citadel and smiles upon it and says, yes, that is you. That is what you are. Because you told it to tell you. You must have verification, acknowledgement, justification for that sense of self that denies its own reality and is made a sub-reality, a virtual virtual world in which you seem to exist for a little moment, to suffer all your pains and joys, and then to die again and again and again and again. And you go to church and you worship a God that seems to smile upon that version of yourself and your version of reality. And it makes absolutely no sense at all. And in the celestial speed-up in which we are now in, there's a very great need to bring about a very real awakening, to shake off the shackles of ancient beliefs and the darkness of all these ideas that you're inflicting upon yourself and you're attempting to inflict upon everyone that you think you love and the world, and to rise up with Jesus and to join in the resurrection.